Everything you've heard in this conference so far has prepared you for this one moment, the closing panel. So I'd like to introduce our panelists in no particular order. Bettina Berendt, professor in computer science at KU Leuven, is that how I say it?
Yes.
In Belgium. Kate Crawford, principal researcher at Microsoft Research in New York City, visiting professor at MIT Center for Civic Media and a senior fellow at NYU's Information Law Institute. Jon Kleinberg, right at the end, Tisch University professor, Department of Computer Science, the Department of Information Science at Cornell University. Hanna Wallach, senior researcher at Microsoft Research in New York and also adjunct associate professor at UMass in Amherst. And finally, myself, I'm Suresh Venkatasubramanian. I'm an associate professor at the University of Utah, and if you've been following along, I'm also a social networking butterfly, so. So the topic, we have a number of things we'd like to discuss in the closing panel, and I think just like in the morning panel, I'm gonna start off with a question. I cheated a bit, I gave them the question ahead of time so they've had a chance to prepare. So I'll just read out the question to all of you. And before I do that, just a note, many of us were at the first Fatimel, as David Robertson puts it, we were all huddled, shivering in a corner of a room in Montreal, all, you know, five of us or 10 of us that were there. And last year we were in Belgium and we had a good, healthy 30 people. And here, it's quite a growth. And of course, you know, it's been quite an experience. And I think some of the discussion that we will have at the panel will be reflections on that growth and how we can, well, grow even more, I guess, and what that means for the community at large. So on that note, the first question. So Fatimel has gone from a sort of a purely academic discussion within the machine learning data mining, at least in the CS side of it, in the from 2008 onwards, when some of the first CS papers, and I emphasize computer science on this, although of course others have done more things, in this area, to sort of a growing awareness both in the press and in the popular press about this issue of bias and algorithms sometime around last year when there seemed to be a critical mass of reports of this kind. And now we have, you know, endorsements from the US government, from the EU, recognitions of the issues of bias. So we've gone quite a long way in a relatively short time. And so the question I asked the panelists to reflect on was, what will success look like 3 or so years from now? Bettina?
Is that on or do I have to press something?
It is in fact on.
Okay. Thanks, Suresh. Thanks, everyone, for having us. It's very exciting to be here. I think one of the most pressing issues is that we leave this discussion of which measures and why not, and have real applications where we make a real difference. And I want to see that in the coming years. Then if we have that, we can have also a more self-critical evaluation of what went well and what went less well in those efforts, where we fail because we are looking actually not in a wide enough sense. For that, the wide enough sense, we need more interdisciplinarity because there's a lot of issues we're discussing here today and we've been discussing for the past years that have been looked at, as Dana said this morning, for a couple of thousand years, some of them maybe a bit less. So also more self-reflexivity about what we're doing, and about this wider scope in general. I would really like to say more in the question on which untapped research questions do we have. Exactly, and so I would like to give over to Hanna.
Okay. So for those of you who don't know me, I'm a machine learning researcher by training, but most of my work over the past 6 years or so has been in the interdisciplinary area of computational social science. This is probably going to influence everything I say today. Okay, that's my disclaimer. So for me, the most important thing is being interdisciplinary. I would like for this community to continue to grow and to grow in a way such that it doesn't just become yet another subfield of machine learning. I'm very concerned that it's certainly possible for machine learning researchers, and we're seeing this already, to get very, very excited about this as a new area. Oh, there's all these exciting untapped problems. But I think if we actually want to make concrete advances in this area, we are going to need to do so in partnership with people outside of machine learning. So I actually have a question here today. How many people in this room are computer scientists? Yeah, okay. So for me, this is a problem. Okay, so then let's ask that one. And how many people are in machine learning? Okay, better. But still, I'm concerned by the number of computer scientists in this room. I think if we actually want this area to start making a real difference that actually has an impact on the world, as opposed to just being a very narrow technical subfield, we're gonna have to involve people from law, from public policy, from science and technology studies, but also people from sociology and even political science as well. I'm going to stop there and hand over to Kate, but I do have a lot more to say on this topic.
Thank you, Hanna. And as the social scientist on the panel, I can just say I can agree with that. And I'm going to take a very different direction. If I was going to ask why the next 3 years are going to be different, I would say we've had, first of all, an extraordinary level of success over the last three, and I'd like to thank Hanna and Suresh and Solon and Joshua and Fernando and everybody who's part of the FATML community for making this so successful. But I think the hard part is yet to come. And I think the frame of the next 3 years is particularly important for us as researchers to ask, what will we do with these tools and what won't we do? And the reason I say this is because we talk a lot about ethics in this community, but we don't actually have our own ethical code to guide us under particularly difficult, I would suggest, political times. So as we know, machine learning is already being used in predictive policing and the criminal justice system and in tracking refugee populations here and in Europe. Might it also be used to track undocumented workers? Might it be used to help create the Muslim registry that we've heard so much about? I would like to say this to this community here, but also to Silicon Valley more generally. I think we all have a responsibility right now to decide where we will put our work and where we will say this type of work is not ethical. I'm not going to say it's going to be easy. Some of the time, work is just going to be basically unscientific and kind of dodgy. I also think it's really important that we call that work out. You might have noticed a paper that was published this week. I've tweeted it out. I know a few others have, which is called Automated Inference on Criminality Using Face Images, which is basically using supervised machine learning to create four classifiers on a data set of 1,856 faces, some of which are criminals and some of which are not, to try and say, well, this is what a criminal's face looks like, so that you could detect them in advance. Now, I would say that in previous years, we might have laughed about this and thought, my gosh, that sounds deeply suspect and very pseudoscientific. It's basically AI phrenology. Great, just what we need. However, in an era when we have police body cams, when we have facial recognition systems deployed in most of our cities, when we have predictive policing, I think this type of work is actually very dangerous. And I think we all have to ask ourselves, if somebody came to you and said, would you create a classifier like this to try and detect terrorists before they do anything, would you take that job? And this is not a speculative question, because there is actually a startup called Faceception, it's based in Israel, that is doing exactly that, that's already got its Series A funding. So these are questions that, as a community, I think this community in particular is so important. And you know why? Because we put values first. We've actually got fairness, accountability, and transparency in the title of this workshop. And that's because we know that values are baked into everything we do, even if they're not stated. So I just think this group is so important, and the people on the live stream are so important, because we are actually going to be able to take a position on some of the hardest decisions under the new regime, and we have to ask, what will we do and what won't we stand for?
Thanks very much. So I'm a computer scientist, and therefore part of the problem that Hanna pinpointed earlier.
They told us here, so don't worry.
Okay, good. Yeah. I would reinforce everything that's been said so far, and I think it, you know, one of the exciting things about this community is the way it has foregrounded the values and what we're doing. I think it, you know, with an area that's growing as fast as this area is, it's going to be particularly important to bring in the perspectives of all the different communities that are involved in this sort of thinking. You know, and I think what we've seen is the value of having end-to-end case studies that we can all look at, because it's very easy to say in the abstract some of the dangers of some of these algorithms, some of the things that can go wrong. But as long as it remains abstract, it becomes very hard to actually diagnose what the heart of the problem is. And so I think to the extent that people have gone into look at some of the end-to-end examples where things have happened, it's been an organizing principle for a number of communities to come around. And I think when you look at the different communities that are brought to bear on this, on these problems, you can actually see how these perspectives interact with each other. One can make a couple of observations. One is that I think in this area, as in many areas, there's this tension between, to sort of use a computer science metaphor, the principles of safety versus liveness, right? So in computer systems, we talk about safety versus liveness. On the one hand, safety, we should not do any harm. On the other hand, liveness, we want to, if there's an opportunity to implement positive change in the world, we want to seize that opportunity, right? And so that tension, I think, is something that we've seen throughout a number of the talks here today, and it's going to, I think, it's going to become all the more crucial. And in a sense, I think whenever we think about that tension, we don't want one to get out of balance with respect to the other. On the one hand, I think we don't want to miss the fact that there's an enormous opportunity to improve people's lives through the kinds of algorithms, the kind of data, the kind of technology that's available. On the other hand, I think, you know, all of us have to think about the scope in which we want to work and the limits on that. A second one, I think, is actually when we bring different communities to bear on this, it's always striking the different timescales over which they think about the problem, right? So on the one hand, you know, we often train people to think about this as an instance of a problem. It begins with the input, the algorithm works, and it produces an output. On the other hand, we could widen the lens and say, no, it's really over a different timescale. It's over the timescale under which the data was actually constructed, the possibly biased way in which it was constructed, maybe the biased way in which the label that I'm trying to predict was constructed, the way in which the algorithm was constructed. And then we could actually widen the timescale even further, the way, for example, the empirical social scientists and economists do, and think about the effect of the decision rules that we make on even subsequent generations of people, right? And the endogenous decisions about how much effort people are going to invest in working hard within a system that they think is making decisions that are unbalanced against them. Mm-hmm. And so the feedback loops actually, I think, operate over many, many different ranges of time. And I think as we engage with different communities, all these styles of analysis are going to come into play, and that's going to be very valuable also.
So a number of themes are coming up, both from the answers that you all have sort of thought about, and also some of the other points that I sort of was thinking about we might want to talk about in regard to how this community will grow. So I think one thing I'd like to hear more about from the panel, and sort of go backwards, starting from John maybe, is this: where, so if you're talking about expansion, if you're talking about looking at, you know, new communities, new discussions, things that maybe we're not quite the unknown unknowns, if you wish. Can you name one? Are there unknown unknowns? Are there communities where, you know, we've talked about a lot of different areas here in these talks today, but it's clearly we're probably missing a bunch of interesting discussions that we should be having. What would you sort of suggest we should be, who should we be reaching out to? Which are the people we should be hearing give talks in the next Fatima, for example, things like that?
Yeah, a great question, right. Yeah, so I guess this is the art of self-reference, where I'll claim to know about the things that we can't possibly know
exactly.
about.
That's right. You're so good a scientist after all.
So after all, I can get my head around it. So, I mean, one thing I'll come back to this fact that I think whenever we hear from people who are really trying to carry out change in the world, the kinds of problems that one runs into, I think it often crystallizes many of the issues that we're grappling with conceptually, and it becomes a focal point for discussion. To take an example that, you know, on the one hand is still very striking, on the other hand is sort of has been used so much during the day today that I hesitate to bring it up one more time. But so the ProPublica report from the summer on risk tools in the criminal justice system, and I bring it up precisely because it's been brought up so much. I think there's, you know, why has that become ubiquitous in discussions and the post-recession and so forth? In part, it's because it's a rare example where, you know, people could actually take an end-to-end example of something where you actually document, you know, something, you know, where algorithms have produced effects that we weren't happy with, where there was data where the community could come and actually replicate some of that, and talk about the trade-offs between the different things you want there. clearly we need many more of those, right? The fact that we keep going back to that one, I think is sort of says all that you need to know about the sort of lack of other examples from different domains. In the end, I think if we accumulate enough of a robust collection of examples from many different domains of, you know, people who are out looking at end-to-end case studies, I think we'll start to appreciate that even what we mean by these definitions, by fairness, by accountability, by transparency, mean very different things in these different domains, and the kinds of things that we should be striving for should be actually expressed more in a language for how it's going to adapt to the different goals we have in different settings.
Okay. Absolutely. Yeah.
So it probably would be best to keep the applause till the end, so because frankly, I think they're all saying interesting things, but then if you feel like you're clapping, everything becomes meaningless at that point. So let's just keep it all to the end. But thank you for your appreciation.
Kate.
No, you don't understand. Sorry, Kate, go ahead.
Okay, well, I would not applaud because I'm not allowed, but I would certainly agree with everything that John just said. And I would also put in a vote for history. So my training is more in the areas of STS, science and technology studies, and also philosophy. I work at Microsoft Research, so I collaborate with people in machine learning and information retrieval and CSS, but I find working with historians is actually one of the most interesting things we can do right now. And why? Because historians have this deep sense of the context of where history comes from. And more I'm turning to that context to really understand how data was made in the first place, before we use it to train a model, before it becomes anything else, is where was it drawn from and what were the histories that produced that data? I'm thinking here of an example in particular, and it was alluded to by Fernando when he he presented our paper two sessions ago, but this is around the Chicago predictive policing heat maps. And what's interesting is that these heat maps are just looking at historical data around where the police had previously been sent to go and capture criminals, where they've been seeing various types of problems emerge. And basically that data was used to say, well, this is likely where those patterns of crime will recur again. Then RAND did a study, which was published just a couple of months ago, to test, the first test of the effectiveness of the heat map. Mm. And what they found was, actual fact, they were completely ineffective, apart from on one vector. They're really, really good at increasing police harassment to the people who are living in the areas on that list. It's fantastic for that. So this should give us some cause for concern. And what should we do about it? So I published a piece in Nature this month with the excellent Ryan Kahlo, who's a law professor based at the University of Washington. And we name what we call a social systems analysis for machine learning and AI, where we actually go back and what sort of methods would you use to understand the deep context of that crime data before you just ingest it as though it's raw facts? And so we look in that Nature article at different things you could do, different ways you could go and talk to people in the community about, does this data reflect what's been happening in your neighborhood? How might it be different? What else do you see? What other ways can we use to actually critically engage with data sets from the very beginning? That's what excites me right now is, you know, how do we draw in other disciplines to create these new interdisciplinary methods of critically engaging with data?
So I want to interject briefly before Hanna starts up, just as an anecdote. So I'd recently given a talk in our university's philosophy department in a class on ethics and engineering, and I was talking about the work on setting context for why people think about fairness. And a philosopher in the audience came to me afterwards and said that, you know, some of the arguments about why algorithms are good and they're objective and we should use them more, are they sort of heavily harken back to arguments in the late 1800s about the use of maps and atlases and about how the creation of this content was going to somehow objectify the way cartographers and others were making their maps. And it was kind of interesting to see that the same arguments we're seeing right now were being used even then to contextualize the use of what they wouldn't have called, but what you now call data-driven approaches to rendering knowledge. And I thought, just in terms of a context history, I think that context was very interesting to me, that you know, in the sense of everything old is new again, I think that's something that...
And that reminds me, critical geographers are fantastic people to collaborate with too, thinking about maps and how maps change over time. Critical
right.
geographers, fantastic for that. Right.
So sorry, Hanna, go ahead.
Yeah, so I would really like to see more engagement with political science. As Kate was saying, these are inherently political issues that we're discussing, and yet I haven't seen a lot of political scientists engage in these conversations. In much of my interdisciplinary work with social scientists, I am working with political scientists. And while I see people from law and people from journalism really engaging with all of these issues, I don't see that same kind of engagement from political scientists. So I would really, really like to see that and for us to think about ways we can sort of bring them into this conversation. And I think it's going to be all the more important over the next few years as the political landscape changes very dramatically. And so I think it's going to be especially important to do this. The other thing that I think I would like to see more of is a continued discussion of issues related to transparency and interpretability. One of the things that I see missing from this, and this is something that Kate and I have discussed before, is transparent to whom? So when I look at all kinds of machine learning models, it's blindingly obvious to me what's going on. But that's because I've been working in machine learning for 16 years. When we talk about transparency, we're clearly not talking about transparent to me. We're talking about transparent to, well, somebody who's not me, but who is that? Is it an end user? Is it somebody with an undergrad CS background? Who is it? So I think it would be really good to start to nail down some of these questions. I also think that in order to do that and in order to start addressing these questions, we're going to have to think about how to communicate uncertainty and probability and things involving uncertain information. And this is non-trivial. It's absolutely non-trivial. This is stuff that statisticians have been worried about for years. In order to do this, I think we'll also have to interact with folks from human-computer interaction, from information visualization, and also from psychology. And so I'd really like to see more of that as well.
First of all, Suresh's remark, for old people like me, we've seen things coming and going even in our own lifetimes. So the automated judge who can have all these scores of people and whether they're guilty or not, that comes at regular intervals and it goes as well. Okay, anyway. So I would like to follow up on the right side of me. So it may be a good new, some piece of good news that there's computer scientists too who work in an interdisciplinary fashion. I regard myself as one of them. And so, for example, what you said, human-computer interaction and psychology and economics has been part of our work. And I think one thing we could enlarge the community by is to tap, first of all, into all that work that's been going on in Europe, which is slightly underrepresented here for about 10 years now. The real story I would like to tell here is, and this again goes into what disciplines do we need. Let us not forget, and we've seen that today more again and again, discrimination is something that people do to people. In social technical systems, machines and algorithms play a part of that, but they are not the thing that discriminates. In the end, it's people. And so I think what we are doing, and now again I'm going back to saying we when I mean the machine learners, which is kind of strange, is to be that way very affirmative of the status quo in the way we're approaching things now. And I think we can do better. So what do I mean by that? And let me be controversial here. We see pictures of police violence. And we say, well, if only that would affect white people as much as black people, that would be fine. We see pictures of people having poor people having no health insurance. We say, as long as this would affect this minority as much as that majority, whatever, it would be fine. We see Nazis burning refugee homes, and it's fine as soon as they're doing it to Syrians, as well as Afghans, to Muslims, as well as any other religious denomination. And I think that is fundamentally wrong. I'm saying that I want to be controversial here. So the question is, how can we begin to address the real issues here, that there is police brutality, that there is discrimination against poor people in the sense of people having no health insurance, or much worse terms, that there is all this hatred that's going on. So what can we, and now again, the data miners, contribute? So I want you to consider a recent election that made the case for having us and them very strongly. This was the piece that the New Yorker ran after last Tuesday. Look at it. And this is really, again, as I say, this is about us and them. Us and them is something that the social psychologists and sociology has been looking at for a long time. And we see things, a lot of research on what furthers this feeling of there is this other group of people that is not us. And there is a lot of research, and then I'm coming to political science, saying, okay, how does that actually lead to genocides? This is not a predictive model. This is just an observation of how genocides that we've observed over the past couple of hundred years have evolved. And we see that categorization and discriminations play very important roles there. So what happened? You have seen last week the discussion about whether Facebook pushed the election because they were favoring all these fake news, and this was particularly bad on the right-hand side of the spectrum. And then there was another piece in Wired saying, no, it wasn't the fake news, it was actually the advertising that was biased. And then I talked to Raid about this morning. We say, we don't really know, only Facebook would know. Why don't we know? I'm sorry, we should. We're the only ones who can explain how personalization and how advertising and how targeted advertising, all this, how this is really brought about. And if we get together with what people have known, with people from social psychology, from sociology, from political science, who have known all along what all these things make with people, we can get a lot further. And we should know, and we should educate the public, and we should push this, and we should make things different. And if big data, and if in the way we do big data, by putting people into little filter bubbles and isolating everybody from everybody else, if we see that this furthers an us and them thinking, if that furthers a discriminatory mindset, then we have to do something about this and reconsider big data. And with that, okay. I want to give to Suresh.
So I think people have brought up many interesting things that we should do or could do. I haven't yet heard anyone say something that, you know, something that could help other communities get closer to us versus computer science. But I think the more important, interesting question here, I think for most people in this room, I think the statements that the panel is making would be relatively non-controversial. Yes, we must engage with political science. I hadn't thought about history, but that's another interesting angle. And a lot of the other areas, you know, social systems analysis, you know, thinking about end-to-end, these are all reasonably uncontroversial positions. What I'd like to ask, though, is how? How exactly? Can you give me mechanisms, specific mechanisms that you think might be effective? One of the things that I'm thinking about here is that, okay, if we're going to have, let's say, to be extremely concrete about this, we're going to have hopefully another event like this in a year, or maybe hopefully for another couple of years. What are the kinds of mechanisms that we would think would be effective to facilitate the kinds of interactions, the kinds of engagements, the kinds of things we need to have happen? Because, you know, just having the event is not obviously going to make all these interactions happen the way we want them to. So anyone, we can go in any order we want. I mean, anyone who wants like to jump in.
I'll jump in.
Hanna, go ahead.
So I think what we're talking about is sort of really the fundamental problem of interdisciplinary work. Mm-hmm. So how do you make sure that people with very different backgrounds actually communicate and listen to one another? I think this is really hard. I don't have any concrete answers in terms of this will be the right thing to do, but I can give you a couple of examples. So in the case of computational social science, I've spent a lot of time actually going to, for instance, political science conferences and sitting down and listening to how they talk about their work to try and figure out how it might differ from how I talk about my work. Also telling them about the kinds of things that's happening in computer science where it relates to what they're doing. I've also spent a lot of time inviting those same people from those disciplines back to my own conferences and workshops in order to present things on their own work. So in other words, what I've done is I've focused on taking one human and moving them over here, or another human and moving them over there. And to be perfectly honest, I think it's one of the most effective ways to do it. Yes, it's super time consuming. Yes, you have to travel a lot, as do they. But at the end of the day, there's something really different about sitting in a room with a whole bunch of people listening to them talk than there is just sitting there and reading their papers or sending them the occasional email. So I think I want to prioritize bringing people from those disciplines here explicitly, and then us also going there to some of these other conferences and venues for these other disciplines.
I would really concur with what Hanna has said. It's kind of unglamorous, but that's how we build a field. And I think really this very interdisciplinary field is what we're really creating here, and it's incredibly exciting. I'd also say that despite the little show of hands, we're actually doing pretty well. The numbers of people in this room obviously has increased at an amazing level since year one, and there are 200 people on the wait list. I mean, that represents a whole range of different disciplines of people who want to be in these conversations. So as a little optimistic note, I think I'm already seeing this sort of shift towards a much broader conversation. And I think that the first thing I would say to answer your, you know, practical, pragmatic question, I think next year we need a bigger venue. I'm just going to say that. And the other sort of second step I would say that's kind of useful in this process is sort of really thinking about... who else is here? We've got regulators in the room. I'm extraordinarily impressed that you came up from DC. I hope these conversations are really fruitful for you. I would like to see this community come to you in DC, particularly during the next 4 years, because there's going to be a lot of work to do, and we'd like to help you. So hopefully we can come to you a bit.
I think also there's sort of a curriculum aspect to this that, you know, if you think about interdisciplinary fields and how they've succeeded, the sad fact is or maybe the happy fact, is that it usually takes a next generation to really cement the gains that have happened. In a sense, like, you know, none of us can really completely fill in the gaps between these disciplines without a next generation of students actually doing it from the ground up. And that means, you know, curriculum development at the undergrad level. It means PhD training. It also, I think, means creative internships, creative ways of spending time in some domain very far from your discipline, you know, whether it's if you're a computer scientist, spending a summer somewhere that's really doing actual policy work, if you're, you know, coming from a non-CS domain, you know, taking part in something where you can develop some computational skills. So I think that sort of thing at the kind of educational and student development level is very important also.
Yeah.
So very practically, and following up on what John said, I also think curriculum is extremely important. And then again, we need to get together and see what's already there instead of reinventing the wheel all the time. So, for example, in Europe, the European Network Agency for Cybersecurity or for Security created a website that has a list of all privacy and to some extent security related courses at university for students, for practitioners and so on. And it's amazing what exists, and I believe there's a lot more in the US that we don't know about. So, you know, I think one of the big lessons learned there is don't reinvent the wheel all the time. There's a lot of people doing similar stuff, and go to these centralized information stores to feed them, to populate them, instead of setting up another one. And I would like to add to the other thing about getting the people. I completely agree. And if you really want to listen to what the other one has to say, it's so much fun. But we also need to see what are the incentive structures. We're not living in an idealized vacuum here. We need to satisfy our scores, as Cynthia would say, our KPIs, And so, you know, what are the incentives? Is it paper publishing? And is it okay for a social scientist to have a paper at some conference of computer scientists, mm-hmm. which doesn't interest them because it's just a conference? And then we start explaining, you know, it's actually harder to get in here than into a journal. We need to have that conversation too about what is it you have to show, what are your channels of being successful, of getting impact, and then targeting these.
Okay. One of the, I think Kate mentioned that we have a lot of people in the room, especially regulators, policy folks who are here, and it's great that you're here, and it's, I think, one of the things that makes this event so attractive is the fact that it's not just, not that there's anything wrong with it, not just a bunch of researchers talking to each other, but we're getting input and feedback on how these connect to the actual end-to-end cases that we're all concerned with. And so, you know, at some point soon, I'm going to open up the panel for questions from the audience. And at that point, if there are folks in the room who are, you know, who are not, you know, CSML research, or people who are here for reasons other than that I'm doing research in this area, I'm also, it'll be interesting for us to hear, you know, why, if you would like to share, you know, why you come here, do you think you'd be, would like to sort of be coming to this kind of event regularly? What would make you want to come? What would make you not want to come? If there are, especially folks coming from way outside the sort of the MLCS kind of domain, that's something that, you know, I think we'd all be interested in hearing about, even if it's not particularly a question for the panel. So think about that while I ask the next question. So one, I had listed this as a boring question. And The reason it's let me use a better word. It is an unglamorous question. So, but also an important one. So, one thing I've been thinking about again in trying to be very concrete about steps to go forward, and that's part of the discussion of this panel is, what are sort of so we've talked about a lot about people activities, right? Activities that we could do to sort of get engaged with the communities. But what would you think would be effective in terms of value for money type things? Infrastructure activities we could be doing to help grow the community around. So again, these are not necessarily things that involve interactions with other communities and people, but sort of artifacts, things we could be working on building, right? So we get some money, we want to build something. What are the things I think that you think would be useful to help fuel for the development from that perspective?
Can I just start there? Because it's kind of a link between the question before and this one.
Sure.
I was just thinking when you said that about the many people out there and what would make them come and so on, what would come to these events. I think what we would need is to make it possible also for people who can't come to New York or to some other fancy location because they simply don't have the funding to go, to take part in the discussion and not just be consumers at the end of a live stream. So that kind of platform for such a discussion would be a huge contribution because we would be doing what we're preaching.
So just a couple of things. So firstly, I think this is something where things like Slack can be very good in terms of building an online community to talk to people sort of on an ongoing basis. I also want to build on something that you said a minute ago about publishing and disciplinary incentives and stuff like that. I think it would make a really big difference if there was some kind of a journal or conference or something associated with this community that people could publish their work in. I recognize that it's going to be non-trivial because of this differences between journals and conferences and all of that kind of thing, but I do think that having somewhere to publish would really help.
Yeah. I'm gonna take a very broad interpretation of this concept infrastructure and talk about a legal infrastructure that I think we could help to intervene on in order to grow this community. And that's the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act. As many of you know, the CFAA has a provision in it which makes it a federal crime if you are going against a website's terms of service. That could be include scraping, that could be doing the kinds of reverse engineering that, say, Julia Angwin did for that ProPublica story that we discussed so much, but also that the investigative journalists use at Bloomberg to show that Amazon's same-day delivery service was avoiding predominantly African-American zip codes. So the kinds of work that has really pointed to how systems were unintentionally discriminatory have in some ways been in breach of the CFAA. So in order for many researchers to feel safe doing this kind of work, I think it would be really important to have a research exemption so that if you are doing work around trying to test if a system is discriminatory, that you should not be committing a federal crime. I think that would be a great help. Obviously, the ACLU is currently putting up a case on this, working with people like Christian Sandvig, who is working on algorithmic auditing. So I think we should try and support that.
I guess in a way, sort of.
Actually, I have a quick question. So, Christo, you're in the back. So, what? You have an update on that? What's going on there?
We're waiting on the judge.
Okay.
Crossing fingers. Right.
That's easy enough. So, Christo Wilson. Christo Wilson from Northeastern. One of the. I guess are you a plaintiff? Is that
yeah,
one of the plaintiffs in the lawsuit? Yeah. Okay. So he's still here, people. So it's all good. Sorry, John.
I mean, it's hard to add much to that. These are all great ideas. If you look at sort of domains that have an impact on thinking about policy, you know, whether it be in medicine and economics and so forth, that as they've developed a larger infrastructure, you often get these curated data sets where the whole community can be talking about the same thing. Because I think, you know, one sign of a community in its early phases is that each piece of research is sort of more of a one-off, and it's very hard to compare one thing to another. But this very much is a domain where we could imagine, you know, with some effort and with some help from governmental agencies, some help from industry, creating some high quality data sets that could be sort of curated and where multiple pieces of research could be done in the same context. And I think that might lead to more direct comparison of results.
Yeah, and for example, since you mentioned ProPublica, at least all the stuff is available on GitHub, so it's very easy to play with the stuff that
right,
we already
and
have.
One could see one could imagine a lot more examples of that.
Right. Okay. I have what I call the lightning round. The rules of the game are, and this is before we go into questions, the rules of the game, you have one sentence, and since we're all academics, I had to define what one sentence means. I've learned, Bela, yeah. No more than 20 words, and I'll ask you all to count. And they, again, they got this question ahead of time, so they can't, you know, they do have it. The question is, in no more than 20 words, state your view of the next concrete research problem or challenge in this area.
I'm counting.
Given our historic and scientific knowledge of how democracy can abolish itself, how to be a fairness researcher after the election?
Okay. Very good. Well done.
That's good.
Was it 20? I wasn't even
it
counting.
Was exactly 20.
Okay, there you go.
So I think it would be really great to focus more on fairness in a context of unsupervised learning. So this obviously relates to the word embedding stuff we saw earlier, but even moving more broadly beyond that, and especially unsupervised models for exploratory analyses. These are just as important as models for predictive analyses.
I was going to talk about interpretability, but Hannah just did. So instead, I'm going to create one sentence that says, I would like to see some rigorous research around data ethics and accountability that we can also use to guide our own actions in this community over the next 4 years.
I would say bring these ideas into end-to-end applications to affect positive change in the world.
Okay. All right. With that, well done, everyone. I'm glad you all stuck to 20. Well, Hannah, I'm not so sure. It seemed like a very generous definition of 20, within a constant factor of 20.
Okay,
so.
Fine.
Questions from the audience for the panel, and if you want to direct it to anyone in particular or to the entire group, I'll leave you to do it. Go for it.
I think one thing I'd like to say is that potentially, as a group, we are in danger of missing the boat. A lot of this stuff is already happening. A lot of parts of the public sector, for example, are trying to work out what ethics looks like in machine learning, and the technical community are not involved in those conversations. The technical solutions and the technical approaches are not integrated. There are some of us in the UK that are trying to put them in there forcibly, but it's very difficult. So I would probably call to the panel and just have an opinion from people on the panel and say, we need to get into procurement systems. We have to try and make standards that represent, like the environmental standards that become procurement requirements, and start forming consortia to actually bid for projects that can be demonstrators of what fairness in machine learning could look like, and use the expertise in this room to start to engage with things that aren't research projects, but are practice projects. So I wonder if this is a good platform to do that, and thoughts about that from the panel.
Any thoughts on that?
I think that's a fantastic point. I would possibly just vary my answer to say that I don't think this community is missing the boat. I think they're one of the very important boats in a flotilla. but there is a flotilla of boats, and some of them are pointing in slightly different directions. The procurement point is one that has been made strongly. It was made strongly at AI Now, which was one of the White House events on the social and economic impacts of machine learning and AI, which I was co-chairing with Meredith Whitaker. I think it's how we do that, how we do procurement, is something that we should be talking to the regulators in this room and people in DC more about. It's an incredibly important strategic intervention.
Kind of piggybacking off of that last question, but more on a micro scale. So we talked about the values that researchers should have and the interdisciplinary nature that the research field should have. But in terms of actually reaching, say, the nameless engineer in company X who grabbed scikit-learn off the shelf and said, oh, this classifier, I'll just throw, you know, data at it. How do we reach them, and how do you start to sort of instill good norms and values with them? And I think this is directed to you, Kate, because I think you talked about value, or anyone who wants to share. Thank you.
John, do you want to have a first go? I think you should go. We'll go down the row.
It works at different levels. I mean, again, one is actually that the training that we do at the educational level ends up feeding into these systems, not just through the people who move there, but through the people that they in turn work with, right? So one should remember that, you know, when any new idea comes along, be it, you know, a while back machine learning, you know, the sort of introduction of economic systems and computer science, it sort of moves faster than the aging of the student population, because as those people go out into companies, they enter into groups where this becomes a shared set of values. So I think it definitely, education is definitely one way. And then, you know, I think to the extent we can, you know, make things, we can open things up, we can share open source tools, we can share data sets. You know, this also, I think, just makes it easier for these ideas to get out into engineering practice. Mm.
Agreed. I mean, I know one of the things that DJ Patil has been working on and the Office of Science and Technology Policy is looking at how data ethics can be built into every computer science course. I don't know if that's going to be sufficient. I think we need to do more. I think it's going to be a lot of this is at a community level. How do we build community norms? How do we draw lines around what's okay and what's not okay? Some of the things I referred to earlier. I think we're about to face some really, really hard questions very, very soon. So what are the guidelines here? I mean, both the ACM and the IEEE have ethical guidelines that are, you know, almost two decades old. I mean, we need to do better in that space. And that's actually why I love FATML, because so many of the discussions here are at a very nuanced and, I think, complex level around how norm making works. But, yeah, we're going to have some real challenges around that.
And just a couple of other things. So I don't know how many of you saw this, but Nautilus magazine, it's a science magazine, had an article on sort of these kinds of issues and interpretability of machine learning and all of that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. And I found that since that happened, I've had many more people say, oh, I saw this article. Oh, I hadn't really been thinking about this kind of stuff, but oh, I guess this is important. And so I think these kinds of sort of more, I mean, I suppose that's not really mainstream media, I guess, but
it got around.
Yeah, sure. But these kinds of more popular articles make a really big difference. The other thing I want to point out is that we actually have one of the lead developers of scikit-learn in the room.
That's right.
And so obviously, yeah, maybe there's something.
May not want
to
reveal himself because.
But more seriously, I think that people who are developing these kinds of toolkits need to be thinking about these issues as well in terms of how their end users might use them. And because we do have one of the developers in the room, I can tell you that is happening for scikit-learn.
So I should interject before you go ahead. Mm-hmm. The term is lamestream media, not mainstream media.
Don't we just call it all fake news? Isn't that like the name? No, it's all fake news.
Bettina, sorry, go ahead.
You mentioned regulators from DC. There's also regulators in Brussels and in many other places.
Yep.
And as many of you will know, Europe will have a new data protection legislation effective as of 2018. The British Data Protection Office says they don't know yet what's going to happen after Brexit, but... okay, anyway, this mandates for every personal data processing that is to be done in the future, whether you do it as the first part, the so-called data controller, or as a subcontractor, a so-called data processor, it mandates that you have to do data protection by design and data protection by default in all your products and services. And there's a very big discussion, a very big confusion. You know, in Canada, we've had privacy by design for a number of years with Anne Kavoukian, and we've had privacy by design here, and we have data protection by design. And what's the difference between data protection and privacy? I can't go into that. But a very important thing here is the discrimination aspect, fairness aspect, as we call it here, is actually framed as part of data protection under the European GDPR, which I think makes a lot of sense. So there is also stuff about profiling in the law and so on. So because there is all this questioning at the moment, what does that actually mean? There is the space now for academics who are devising frameworks for how to do this by design and by default. But getting into the discussion, getting into companies, advising companies. I've had lots of people from companies ask me, do you know about the GDPR? Could you give us some hints? And so there is a general openness that I feel, which I think we should really exploit and explore.
So on that, just a brief note before Dana goes on, just a shout out. So Sorel Friedler, Nick Diakopoulos have an article today in the MIT Tech Review, which is now actually on their website, on how to hold algorithms accountable. It has, Sorel, why don't you just quickly describe in like 10 seconds or less?
So. So this is coming out of a doctoral workshop. The sort of workshop developed 5 principles we should try to work towards for holding algorithms accountable. And this article is Nick and I sort of trying to explain some of those. And the full principles document, which is linked off of the FADML website, also includes what we're calling a social impact statement, which is sort of like an environmental impact statement type of thing, but with a list of suggested questions that people should consider answering before deploying these systems.
Right. Dana, sorry for keeping you waiting.
So I think Kate's totally right that this is about building a flotilla, and this is actually where I think I disagree with Hannah, which is that I actually want to see a lot more computer scientists at the table. And I think that some of the most important and challenging issues that go in front of us are not about when computer scientists are just talking about broader social issues, but actually trying to solve some of the very unique technical problems that I think we got to hear throughout the day. And I really want to emphasize this because I'm concerned that there are not enough spaces out there right now where people are actually trying to develop meaningful interventions, trying to develop and complicate existing models, trying to really tease out what can be uniquely offered from computer science. And I say this because one of the questions I have for all of you is not what computer science can do for everything else of policy and social issues, but what are the technical questions that you think you guys are uniquely positioned to be able to address, and how do we look at computer science not just as an outpost, but like as somebody who's like actually trying to address these same issues. And I guess this is some of John and I have talked about this a little bit, which is that I think John's trying to really think about what is the language that computer science can give to social issues, rather than just always expecting social issues to come to technical. So I'm curious, like, what can computer science uniquely offer
you? Firstly, I knew you were going to ask this question because I did check my email while I was on the panel, and I saw you email me. And so
ouch,
I prepared some remarks. So I actually completely...
So you got the answer ahead of time. So.
I did. I actually completely agree with you. And I want to be very clear that I didn't mean that we should not have computer scientists involved, or we should have fewer computer scientists involved, or anything like that. All I want to do is make sure that the computer scientists, and I'm talking actually specifically about the machine learning people who are involved, are thinking beyond the kind of, oh, wow, fairness, okay, that's another objective function that I can optimize view. And the reason why I bring this up is that back in 2015, much of the work, technical work in this space, was focusing on classification accuracy and trading off accuracy with one particular definition of fairness, namely the EEOC's 80% definition. And I understand why that was happening. It is an exciting new objective function. We can trade these things off against accuracy, yay. And that is a great definition from a point of view of being very easy to quantify, but it's just not enough. And so I want to make sure that the computer scientists who are working in this space are willing to really sort of branch out and engage with the field as a whole, as opposed to one easily quantifiable sliver of it. That's all. But I actually totally agree with you.
Yeah. Can I add to that?
Sure.
Dana, I have a simple answer to your question. Whenever I sit, let's say, in policy discussions or in discussions with social scientists, I feel a very strong sense of determinism in them. So whatever comes from computers seems to be as it is. I think our task is to explain, nope. It's actually surprisingly difficult to convince a social scientist who should be familiar with that things are not so unique and so easy and so simple, that there are choices that can be made in how computers are designed and how systems are set up. And that is our task, to know about these choices, to explore them, and to explain the non-technical people that there are choices and that it is a power decision to make a system in one way and not in another.
So I would like to keep moving along. We have a number of people who want to ask questions, and they've been standing very patiently. Julia, go ahead.
And unfortunately, my first question is a comment, and that is that the ACM is starting to revise for the first time since 1992 its code of ethics. And in the December issue of the communications of the ACM, they will publish the first draft, and they will solicit input from the community. And this is just a perfect room which to make aware that this is coming out, and you should all be reading the draft and very actively participating in its revision. So that's the first thing that I want to say. And the second is that, of course, I'm on board with being transdisciplinary and including people outside of computer science in the research here, but I also want to say that we need to be more diverse and more inclusive within computer science. So I represent the database community here, and I've taken upon myself, together with my colleagues, to really bring us to the table here, to start a dialogue with machine learning, data mining, security and privacy, to say that all of these problems cannot be solved in kind of a box at a time, an algorithm at a time, but instead we need all hands on deck, and we need solutions that are systems solution, and this solutions. And this is something that we can bring back to the communities of practitioners here, if we give them a database, let's say, that is both efficient and fair, wouldn't that really involve them? So, sorry, both of these are kind of comments. But
they're very good comments. I mean, we have reserved the domain fatcs.org, or maybe we haven't, I'm not sure. But it's a good, it's a valid point.
So the term for us is data responsibly, so remember that.
Hi. I have no question, just comments, but I'll be happy to answer yours if you have for me. So I am one of the non-data science, non-machine learning algorithm persons, attendees today. I am a PhD economist, though, so that puts me sort of in the technical realm. And it's been a pleasure to see a research conference that isn't econ-focused and interesting conversations. And you should add economists to your list of social scientists you should care about, because we actually have been doing work in discrimination for many, many years, both in the academic field. And in practice. So I was talking to someone earlier today about some recent podcasts, and there have been a series over the summer about fairness in algorithms and whatnot, and I distinctly remember one of them driving home to Ohio on a road trip, and I was screaming at the radio at the window, like, why? So I think there was a discussion about, should we care about fairness? Should we care about discrimination? And I work for a regulator that has enforcement and supervisory authority for the ECOA, which basically says you can't discriminate on the basis of a number of protected classes, characteristics including race and ethnicity and others in credit decisioning. It also, interestingly, requires adverse action notices to be provided to consumers when they're denied access to credit. So I was screaming at myself or at the steering wheel or at the dashboard because it seemed like the conversation was happening in a vacuum. Without really understanding the context in which these models are often being used and the legal framework that applies to those contexts. And specifically, thinking of the ECOA and credit, I'm thinking of Title VII, and I'm thinking of housing, the FHA, which have pretty specific anti-discrimination requirements. And so I just encourage all of you to sort of think about the context in which these models are being used. And I think that will naturally lead you to thinking about the policy discussions that you could be really influential in. I would also offer that in forums like this and conversations like this, to have a session that is maybe more policy focused. Mm-hmm. I think you will, one, then come to understand how the outside world is using these technologies. And I think that you will also generate interest from those policymakers and people who are doing work in that area. Yeah. Their interest in coming to these types of events. And just finally, I want to add that in terms of the interdisciplinary and the working together thing that you raised earlier, at the Bureau, on issues like this, it brings together folks like myself, economists, attorneys, people in our markets teams who have very deep knowledge of how the markets work, how credit scores are computed. And so in our work, we build those interdisciplinary teams to actually think through what our policy positions are going to be or what the solutions should be. So I think identifying those types of opportunities would be helpful as well. Thanks. Well,
thanks for that, Tina.
My name's Ann Washington, and I teach at George Mason University. And I've been doing the hard work of interdisciplinary work on an NSF grant I've been working on. Some people in the room know about it. It was called Political Informatics. And we were trying to get political scientists to use computational methods. I should say that I'm a reformed computer scientist. I teach in the policy school, right? And I also struggle with examples, because a lot of times when I'm trying to explain to people in the policy world what this means, it's very hard to make any of this concrete. The goal of that, the political informatics grant, was to use more open government data and open data so that way everybody could play with it and see it. So my question sort of to you or to the audience, if you have ideas to come up and tell me later, is what can we use that's public that therefore we can see and work out some of these issues so that way it's visible, and with that visibility we can have greater conversations.
Anyone? I would definitely make a shout out for data.gov, which is something that I think of as a very good source, but maybe others.
I mean, I guess, I mean, some of the data sets being released by municipal governments also, I think, you know, have a lot of interesting, I think that there's a lot more that could be done with those than has been done so.
And I think this also relates to your point about case studies as well.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So showing not just sort of, oh, here's some data that you can all use, but what you can do with it, and what the you know, maybe
yeah.
good things are, maybe bad things are that you can do.
Yeah,
with
I
it.
Mean, I think it comes back to also this tension between the safety versus liveness and what we do. That the same data set can both illustrate sometimes the risks, but also some of the untapped potential, right? Some of the ways in which there's sort of things just lying out there that if we could have the right algorithm or the right way of analyzing the data, could actually bring about positive change.
So first off, I just want to say thank you all, because this really is an amazing community. I'm here not as an academic, I'm actually a journalist on the team that you mentioned at Bloomberg. And I really just got up here because I wanted to let everybody know that you should also be reaching out to journalists and explaining your research to them. We are not all bad. I mean, just like if you think about it, AI is one of the most hyped up things in the media, and kind of a voice of reason is this, like you guys have presented a voice of reason throughout like this entire event. My motivations for coming here were actually because, you know, when we first were working on that story particularly, it was really difficult. For us, we, you know, had a really, kind of ran into a lot of roadblocks, you know, we actually got to the kind of the thing we published. We got to like almost immediately. You know, we just plotted it on a map, we were trying to do something more quantitative, but that we found that to be very difficult. So I kind of had wished there was like something like stats.org. For like machine learning, and maybe just the ethics of it, or just you know maybe understanding what something is. I don't know. That's So.
Okay, thank you. And
just if anybody hasn't read that story, can I just say, please do. It's a stunning piece. It's Bloomberg. Just look up Bloomberg, Amazon, same day delivery. But that was an important work. So thank you so much. And also to researchers in the room, go and approach journalists when you have something that you think could really be useful, because we are blessed that we have a core of people who really care about these issues.
I mean, I will say that any claims to fame I have was because I got put on a Science Friday podcast with Kate Crawford. and that really helped me. So definitely, it's if talk to journalists, definitely help. We have one last question. I'm sorry. So you'll take the last. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
Hi, I just wanted to pitch in for interdisciplinary discussion with other technical fields as well, such as operations research or economics and statistics, which have also been looking at questions of resource allocation, revenue management for a long time, and could definitely also be part of the discussion of fair resource allocation and fair revenue management, as well as causal inference in statistics, program evaluation, econometrics, and looking forward to future discussions.
Okay. All right. I think I'd just like to thank the panel, Bettina, Hanna, Kate, and John. Thank you very much for doing this, and thanks to everyone for being here and participating. Hand things back to our fearless leader. So.
Well, just really thank you all for coming today. I mean, it's extremely heartening to have such a large group of people come here. I imagine that not only for me, but for many other people in the room, you put yourself in a somewhat uncomfortable position to try to follow along with work you may not fully understand. I really appreciate it, and I want to really applaud you guys also for just being here, and I hope we can rally and put a lot of this energy to good use. So thanks very much.